ovarian cancer. It is the second most common of all the genital cancers. Now we have some risk factors and protective factors regarding this cancer. The risk factors here are age. The age of women between 45 to 60 years at increased risk. The women is usually nulliparous or of low parity. Women with previous polycystic ovarian syndrome or on tamoxifen, that is a drug used for breast cancer. High calorie and high fat diet. Now, genetic predisposition with BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes, and this predisposition is usually autosomal dominant inherited pattern. Late menopause and hormonal replacement therapy in menopausal women also increases the risk, and breast and GIT cancer also increases the risk. Now, protective factors here are multiparity, breastfeeding, on ovulation, and use of oral contraceptives. Now, classification, histological classification available of ovarian cancer is histologically they are grouped into epithelial ovarian cancers and also non-epithelial ovarian cancers. But the majority of cancers are epithelial. Usually 80 to 90% of ovarian carcinomas are epithelial origin and the rest are non-epithelial. The epithelial ones can be further divided into serous, mucinous, endometrioid, brainer tumor, clear cell carcinoma, and also undifferentiated carcinoma. Among these epithelial ovarian cancers, the highest malignancy is seen in serous type. Now, non-epithelial carcinomas, they further can be of some germ cell origin, sex cord stromal cell origin, metastatic cancers, and also rare malignancies. Now, germ cell origin carcinomas can be further dysgerminoma, endodermal sinus tumor, embryonal carcinoma, polyembryoma, choriocarcinoma, mixed forms, and also teratoma that can be mature dermoid cyst, immature, or monodermal. Now, the characteristic for these germ cell tumors are that they secrete some biochemical substances that can be used as tumor markers. Dysgerminoma, but except dysgerminoma, because it secretes lactase dehydrogenase. Important biochemical markers here are from endodermal sinus tumor that secretes alpha fetoprotein, embryonal carcinoma secretes alpha fetoprotein and SCG, and choriocarcinoma secretes high levels of human chorionic gonadotropin or SCG. Now, next is sex caudal stromal cell origin. They can, as they originate from sex cords, so they either consist of female cells or of male cells. Female cells, granulosa or theca cells, and male cells, that are Sertoli or Leydig cells. And we also have here undifferentiated type of cells that we call mesenchymomas. Next are metastatic cancer. Metastasis from various parts can occur in ovary, from primary growth in GIT, pylorus, colon, and rarely small intestinal carcinomas can also metastasize in ovary. And important one here is Krukenberg tumor, that is the primary carcinoma of stomach, large bowel, and breast that comes and metastasizes in ovary. Now, rare malignancies seen here are lipid cell or Lippert cell tumor, sarcoma, that is a very rare one, and also chorioepithelioma. Now, two important points here is that granulosa cell tumor, that is this one, it secretes inhibin that can be used as a tumor marker for this tumor. And also male cell tumors, these Sertoli or Leydig cell tumors, are called endoblastomas and arginoblastomas. Now, the next we have is spread. Now, this tumor can be spread by three ways. It can have a direct spread, lymphatic spread, and rarely blood spread. Direct spread is to the regional areas of pouch of Douglas, paracolic gutter, subdiaphragm on right side, liver, and peritoneum. Now, clinical features of this tumor is it is non-specific in early stages, but it grows rapidly and causes abdominal discomfort and pain. It causes abnormal or postmenopausal bleeding. An abdominal lump may be felt. Weight loss, cachexia, anemia are present are the signs in advanced stages, and ascites is often present with these tumors, with the ovarian fibroma, with the Brenner tumor, and rarely with granulosa cell tumor also. Now, for the staging, further is staging of this tumor. We have a classification system that is called FIGO staging. According to this classification system, this carcinoma is divided into four stages. In stage 1, we have further 1A, 1B, and 1C. In stage 1, the tumor is confined to the ovary or both ovaries. But the difference here is that in 1A, only one ovary is affected. In 1B, both the ovaries are affected. And in 1C, one or both the ovaries are affected, but their capsule is ruptured. Whereas in these two stages, the capsule is intact. Now, malignant cells in first A and first B are not recognized in ascitic or peritoneal fluid if ascites is caused. But in 1C, we have positive malignant cells. Then in further we have stage 2. Stage 2 tumor involves one or both the ovaries and it has extended into pelvis. It is further subdivided into stage 3A, 2A, 2B and 2C. In 2A, tumor is extended or implanted into uterus or tubes. It involves uterus or tubes, but the malignant cells are not detected in ascites or peritoneal fluid. In 2B, extension is there to other organs in pelvis, and also we do not have any malignant cells in the ascitic fluid. But in 2C we have tumors as in 2A and 2B, that is in the pelvis, and malignant cells are detected in ascitic fluid. In stage 3, tumor involves one or both ovaries with microscopically confirmed peritoneal metastasis is there outside the pelvis, and also we have regional lymph node metastasis. Now important thing here is that in stage 3 we have liver capsule metastasis. It is further subdivided into stage 3A, 3B and 3C. In 3A, we have microscopic peritoneal metastasis, that is beyond the pelvis. In 3B, the length or the dimension of metastasis is less than 2 cm in greatest dimension. But in 3C, the dimension is more than 2 cm, and also we have regional lymph node metastasis. The last one is stage 4. In stage 4, we have distant metastasis that occur beyond the peritoneal cavity or beyond the ovaries. And here we have liver parenchymal metastasis. In stage 3, we just had capsule metastasis, and stage 4, liver parenchyma is also metastasized. Now further investigations for this carcinoma. The first investigation should be CT, MRI. Then we can see the tissue markers. As I said, in epithelial, in germ cell tumors, we can have some biochemical substances that can be checked, like inhibin, HCG, alpha fetoprotein, etc. Now further, we can have CA125 levels are elevated in epithelial tumors, and also CEA levels, that is carcinoembryonic antigen levels are high, but they are not specific. These both things are not specific just for ovarian cancers. Further, barium x-ray breast examination, x-ray chest and liver scan can be done for seeing the metastasis. Ultrasonography and also Doppler of the ovary can be performed to see the blood supply. Now further is management. Laparotomy and maximal reduction of the tumor is the gold standard. Management is done according to the stages. In stages 1 and 2, total hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy, that is combined with amentectomy. In stages 3 and 4, only debulking surgery and removal of tumor is done. Debulking surgery is done to reduce some pressure symptoms, and then the removal of tumor. Now, postoperative radiotherapy and chemotherapy are necessary in stages 3 and 4. In case of recurrency, in case of recurrent tumors, second look surgery should be done, and then removal of the lesion that is causing the recurrency, chemotherapy for visceral metastasis and radiotherapy for lymph nodal metastasis. Now, other modalities are palliative and adjuvant therapy, consist of nutrition, pain relief, psychological support, and also symptom relief.